good luck.
You know, you just look like a comedian. Oh. Doesn't he?
He's not going to be on the radio now.
I didn't like him anyways. So, this is, you know, this is great to see you all. I love coming out here to Billy's church, and I like Las Vegas. It might be because it's so much holier than the place I come from. I don't know. What? I mean, how many of you have transplanted from California? Just see. All right, so, yeah, sticks and stones, you can throw them at me all you want, but I do have a theory about this. He said, he's talking about coming out of California, speaking the truth. This is what I think, and if you're from California, you get it. So I was born in 1959 in Los Angeles, and you, from the beginning, you're in a fight. You realize, and once you are born again, you realize, oh my, I'm in a spiritual fight. So I've been in that spiritual fight for almost 35 years, and you're in it, and I think what it is, it's constant training. So when really weird stuff does come up, you're ready to just box. So you have Jack Hibbs is there, James Cadiz, Tim Thompson, and a bunch of my other colleagues. We're all like within this circle, and it's just the craziest thing. But it is so dark there. It really is. I come out to Vegas because there's a lot more spiritual light out here. It's just an amazing thing. Go figure. But, hey, listen, I'm going to get going. What time do I need to be finished with this?
Tomorrow.
All right. Where's Matthew? Did he leave? He left, didn't he? Wow, that guy just said he wants to be my friend. Forget. Okay. So tell Matthew we're not friends. Okay. But what time do I, seriously, what time do I need to be wrapped up? Well, what time, I mean, I can go, I was only going to go like 45 minutes, but we'll just see what happens then, right? I'm warning you, things pop in my head and come out my mouth, and is this on YouTube, Billy, Pastor Billy? It is on YouTube. No. Yeah, because you're used to it. This is great. This is so cool. Okay, we're going to have hopefully a little bit of fun and a whole lot of truth. And let's see. So before we get to the message, I just real quick, I'm going to do a little bit of promo, okay? First promo is for my app. It is free to download my app. Does anybody in here have that downloaded? Okay, cool. So it works. I did my first live-only app just the other day. Was anybody able to, you caught that? Wow, that's cool. Because we weren't able to advertise it, couldn't let people know. We don't have an alert system set up yet. And it's really cool. So every Wednesday I'm going to be doing just on the app, which means it'll also be on the website, whether you have a PC or a laptop, or it'll be on Roku at the same time, Apple TV, it's still on. However, like Billy, and like Brandon, and like a whole lot of our other colleagues, YouTube is not real friendly with us. And we've been censored numerous times. We can see the writing on the wall. It's just a matter of time before it's a permanent elimination of us from general social media. So I encourage people, hey, download the app. It's free to download. It's how I'm going to be able to communicate. Like Billy, like Brandon, it's just, look, and like apparently with Southwest Radio, they're recognizing, hey, we got to do this. And we want to be able to communicate the truth as much as we possibly can until we are taken out of here. And we're going to move forward, right? I'm guessing you're at a conference like this because you're about forward motion. Amen? And Jesus is coming. But with that, the app is free. Oh, I do have these books. They are available. $100 each. No, they're not very much, and they're really good books. I mean, they really are. I can't believe it. I have another one that's coming out hopefully by Christmas too. But they're actually good books. I mean, I grew up going to Catholic school, and the nuns were telling me nothing good is ever going to come out of you, I mean, it doesn't, even my mom can't believe I have books. But anyways, these books are available out there, and I'll sign them for you if you want. Okay, I better pray because I'm going to get way off track here. You ready? Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to be here. Thank you for Pastor Billy opening up this church for this conference. Thank you for Matthew, the whole team from Southwest Radio, just being a blessing, wanting to do this conference here in the Vegas area. We praise you. I ask that you would be glorified in Jesus' name. Amen. Seriously, with Matthew, who was doing the announcements, he's really he's a guy. I was going to say he's a great guy, but I'm not. Yeah. No, he seems like it. I've only known him like 18 hours. So, but yeah. He lied, though. He said he's known me 25 years. I walked in when he said that. It was a he was joking. I knew he was joking. I'm joking. I joke a little bit too. Is that all right? And I have an extra hour and a half to preach, so I'm going to joke a lot in the next few minutes. Okay. So Jesus, is he really coming? Okay. So we're going to look at 10 reasons for Bible prophecy that give us strength. It'll build our faith, and it will also help us to realize, yes, indeed, Jesus is coming, and we can tell based upon what the Bible says. Okay, with that, there was a time, it was 2002. My wife and I were going up to Oregon. We were leaving Southern California. We were driving up to Oregon to see her family. And up in the Portland area, our son was 10 months old at the time. Our son, who happens to be working with me now, had this thing. Oh, wait, I take this back. This is on the way back from Oregon, not on the way there. And so we're coming back from Oregon. We're coming along the coast of Oregon and California coast. It's cold, it's dark, it's damp up there. And I had never seen it before. It was beautiful, but we had to get over to Redding, California. And I wasn't sure exactly how to get there. And this is in the days before GPS. How many of you remember Thomas Guides? Okay, so no, right? How many of you only know GPS? Listen, life without GPS was more difficult, trust me. So you get out your Thomas Guide, and it's a book, a map, and you flip. You have to basically line the course you're going to take. You go to the next page, line it out. You write what exits you're going to have to be on. You go all this stuff, right? So we're on the California coast, and we have to get to Redding, California, to our hotel. And I'm thinking, wow, we aren't anywhere near Redding. And I think it was around noon when I realized we had to get to Redding. So I look at the Thomas Guide, and I realize, okay, we can go back up whatever road we are on, go into Oregon, cut across, and come down, I think it was the 5 freeway. And then we'll be in Redding. And I looked at it and went, man, we got to go up here, over here, over here. This is crazy. And so I looked at my Thomas Guide, and I saw this road, and it was only about that long on the map. And I realized, oh, we can get from right where we are, it's only a few miles up, right where we are, and there's Redding. We'll be there in minutes. It did not work out the way I had planned. And I realized, okay, I am not a good, the only instruction manual I've ever effectively read is the Bible. Apart from that, I am absolutely awful at it. So I didn't read any of the map legends, like what this means and stuff like that. And this road I had chosen, apparently, it was an old logging road, and it was just weird stuff, all right? So I go, look, honey, we'll be there in minutes. So we start on this road, and everything seems normal for about a mile. And then I see this sign, and I thought, I've never seen a sign like that ever in my life. I look at the sign, and the sign said, not kidding you, it said, Windy Road. I said, Windy Road? How would they know it's a windy road? And then we started going a little bit further, and I realized real windy, and I said, and I asked my wife about it. She said, you idiot, that wasn't windy, that was windy road. I said, I asked her, it's absolutely true. So this road was so crazy, there were times where I had to pull up, back up just to make a turn and then go. It was like this. It was a scary road. When it said the road narrows, it got narrower and narrower and narrower. And she's here. She'll verify everything. This is going to make some of you think I'm evil, but before I was a believer in Christ, I watched a movie called Deliverance. Did anybody see that? This road, we're driving on part of it. And I look, and there's this, and Jackie saw it too, there's this house, and there's these two guys on the porch, just rocking back and forth on their porch. And I was like, oh, we're going to die. If this car breaks down, it took hours and hours and hours and hours. We pulled into the hotel around midnight. Lesson learned. You got to learn how to read signs. Amen?
Amen.
You need to read the instruction manual if you want to be able to tell the way that things are going. And the Bible gives us all kinds of signs to help us understand. If you misread the signs, you're going to be a mess. You're not going to be able to understand what the Bible really does say. Listen, I see guys all the time, pastors, that do not teach Bible prophecy. In fact, I have a friend of mine from Texas. He sent me a picture just last night of this pastor just rebuking anybody for being stupid enough to believe in Bible prophecy. And, it's all over out there. Pastors, I'm sure you're well aware of that, say, don't read the Old Testament. We need to unhitch ourselves from the Old Testament. Stay away from anything in the New Testament that people say is Bible prophecy. Don't read the book of Revelation. And just, the nonsense just goes on and on and on. But we do need to know how to read the signs. We need to understand what the Bible actually does say. So with that, let's get going and let's talk about this. Really? Jesus is coming no matter what your friends or family or other churches may say, because that number seems to be rather small for people who really do believe. So first reason for Bible prophecy, number one is this, is it shows that only God can be trusted. 2 Peter chapter 1, I'm going to have various passages I'm going to read from, all right? 2 Peter chapter 1. Verse 19, Peter writes, "And so we have the prophetic word confirmed, which you do well to heed as a light that shines in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. Knowing this first, that no prophecy of Scripture is of any private interpretation, for prophecy never came by the will of man, but holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit." I look at this and I think, in a sense, all the Bible is prophetic, because really the word prophecy in the biblical sense, it means forth telling the truth of the Word of God. Now, in some circles, it's often just brought into a predictive sense. But Bible prophecy, this is it. This is how this works out for me. For me to understand Bible prophecy and know prophecy, all I got to do is open up the Bible. I don't have to have dreams. I don't have to have visions. I don't have to have any of those things. I'm not here to talk about those things. But the Bible tells us what we need to know. And here Peter writes in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 19, that we have the more sure word of prophecy as a light that shines in the dark place. And I think you'll agree with me that we live in a very dark world. And we have the bright light of God's word that, as the psalmist said in Psalm 119, is a light that shines on our path. So we can open it, we can see it, we can go, aha, I get it. I'm going to be okay because I know that only God can be trusted. And if I read the signs and interpret them according to the Bible itself, it's going to be all right. When I see all of the crazy stuff going on, which we'll look at some in a few minutes, we're going to go, man, if you don't know the Lord, no wonder why people are so messed up. But if you know the Bible, you know the Lord, and you know the Bible, and you know Bible prophecy, you can say, man, it's going to be okay. Okay, check this out. This is, let's see if this works here. This is me, actually, driving down the street. Not sure if the video is going to work. Didn't work. Okay, so this is a church that's near our house. I took this video. I was driving down the street and I saw it coming this way and I was going back. And I saw this sign I'm going to show you in a minute. And, you know, they claim to be Christians. They have a Christian name. It's anything but Christian, trust me. They got issues, serious issues. Okay, see, can you guys see this sign right? Right there. Yeah, you see it, right? See that sign right there? This is what it says. Oh, hey, the video did work. Wow. Okay. I tell you, go figure. Well, there, okay. And so there's a sign again. So that's the inside of my car. Okay, isn't that great? Okay, there it is. Can you see that? Psychic fair. They're inviting people to this so-called Christian, it's not Christian, but they have Christian in their name, to their church. They've got a rainbow bookstore they advertise for and all these different things. So these things are in the church as a whole. Believe it or not, I'm sure some of you are paying attention. The majority of churches in America, Christian in name, disdain what we're talking about here, which is really interesting. But in that, they fulfill Bible prophecy, 2 Peter chapter 3. In the last days, scoffers will come, walking according to their lusts, saying, where's the promise of his coming? Our fathers talked about this stuff. What's that? That infers that it is people who grew up in the church. Our fathers used to tell us Jesus was coming. That's exactly what Peter is saying. We used to hear about it at Sunday school. There's a church in Temecula, California, where the lead pastor, it's a huge church, probably 10,000 people, just entered into a government contract to build for something like $50 million a new portion of their school. In it, they had to agree with the government not to talk about Jesus within that, right? So this is, I could tell you all kinds of things. It's a huge church. And the lead pastor used to be, he grew up going to the church that Tim LaHaye was at, and then David Jeremiah, right? So he got Bible prophecy. He hates it. Pushes back against it. Full-on woke church, right? So that's 2 Peter chapter 3. Walking according to their lusts. What do you mean Jesus is coming? Our fathers used to tell us that. Walking according to their lusts is key. People want to do, they want to fill up their own desires with whatever it is. And that's the world that we live in. And really, you aren't going to be able to trust the psychic. Now, I did see in downtown Vegas yesterday that you can go to all kinds of psychics down there. But in small towns, you can too. And people gravitate toward this stuff. Okay. It shows, Bible prophecy shows that only God can be trusted. Number two, it proves that the Bible is God's word. The fact is that the Bible is the only book ever written that contains genuine fulfilled prophecies. Prophecies regarding ancient nations, things that have been fulfilled in history. I mean, you have prophecies about the Roman Empire. You have prophecies about the Greek Empire. You can go prior to Daniel. You can look at other of the prophets, minor and major prophets, but you can go further than that. You can go back earlier in the Bible and you can find prophecies about other territories and other nations, seeing them already fulfilled. We have the prophecies regarding Jesus Christ in his first coming that have been fulfilled. When I think of that, I think it's David Reagan who says there's 105 prophecies regarding the first coming of Jesus Christ that have been fulfilled. Every single prophecy about Jesus in his first coming has been fulfilled. Some scholars will say, well, there's over 300 prophecies of the first coming of Christ. What Reagan says is, some of those are duplicated. So he takes it to a conservative number. It's 105 or 106, somewhere right in there. Every single one of those prophecies were fulfilled. The Messiah would be born in Bethlehem. He'd be called out of Egypt. He'd be from the Galilee area, a.k.a. Nazareth. All these different things. And every single one of them were fulfilled. How much he'd be betrayed for. He'd be crucified. All these different things. There are, Tim LaHaye used to say, five times as many Bible prophecies regarding the second coming of Christ as his first coming. That's a lot. That would put us well over 500 prophecies. I think it's Joel Rosenberg who says there's over 8 times as many prophecies of the second coming of Christ as his first coming. That would put us at over 800. Why would we have so many prophecies? I like what Tim LaHaye used to say, and I wholeheartedly believe it, because God knew that when we get closer and closer to the age, you and I were going to need to be 8 times as sure that all of these prophetic things were true. I sat down one day several months ago, and I had about 10 minutes to spare. I started typing out Bible prophecies. And so let me just type some out. And I typed out a lot. And then since then, I just started adding to it when something comes into my mind. I'm not going to read them all. On this list, currently, I have 99. I thought of another one last night. I forgot to write it down. And now I can't remember what it is. But, you know, they pop into my mind. Go, I got to write that down, right? But here's just a few. Apart from restored Israel and Israel gathering unbelief and so forth. Another one is the organized church will turn away from the faith. Church people will mock those that believe in Bible prophecy. There'll be rise in anti-Semitism. I'm not going to read them all, I promise. Unbelievers will not understand the signs of the times, but genuine believers will understand the signs. That's Daniel chapter 12, where Daniel is told by the angel, listen, Daniel, at that time of the end, the wicked will see it and they will not understand, but the wise will see it. They will understand. In other words, the wicked and the wise are both going to know something's wrong in the world. But the wicked are going to look, they're going to go, you guys are full of conspiracy theories, right? But the wise will see it. They're going to go, aha. I would guess that there's several of you in the last 3 years, the light went on and you went, man, I never would have believed this Bible stuff before, but now I see it and it's true. I mean, Bill Maher, that atheist on TV, that guy's waking up to the truth. He's actually anti-woke, which is really weird. But you're watching this. And we're seeing churched people becoming very hard towards this. And we're seeing people who are atheists, unchurched. They're going, wow, there's something here. It's a light shining in this dark world. There's more, a lot more. Jerusalem would be owned by the Jews, but the Gentiles will trample it. The world will look for one leader of a new global system. I mean, are they? Oh, yeah, they are. Everybody will have an identification mark, or they'll not be able to buy or sell or function in this world. The world will be characterized by lawlessness, lack of genuine love, violence. The world will be characterized by people being offended because of the name of Jesus. Right? Jesus said that himself in Matthew 24, many will be offended because of me. How many people are offended? I mean, it's like you say anything. And you offend like 90% of the world, it seems. They're just so offended. How could you call me a girl when I'm a boy? Well, you are a girl. Well, I want to be a boy. So then they want to sue you. Listen, it's a sad thing. Because what's happening with kids right now is they're being lied to by adults. They're being lied to by judges. They're being lied to by doctors. I'm not saying all judges, all doctors, all politicians are bad. But they're being lied to by teachers, by school boards, and they're being manipulated. The devil wants them. And we need to be praying for them. But man, some people actually think they're cats. They think they're dogs. Just horrible things. There's a lot more on here, so I'm gonna skip through these so I do get done by noon. This one's really cool, all right? I'm going to read this to you. Psalm 102. I was reading my Bible one day, and I go, how did I miss that? Well, because it didn't make sense until recently. Psalm 102, right, says this. I'll read starting at verse 12. But you, O Lord, shall endure forever, and the remembrance of your name to all generations. You will arise and have mercy on Zion, for the time to favor her. Yes, the set time has come. For your servants take pleasures in her stones and show favor to her dust. In other words, delight in the dirt. That's interesting. Your servants take pleasure in her stones and delight in the dirt, show favor in her dust. So the nation shall fear the name of the Lord and all the kings of the earth your glory. For the Lord shall build up Zion and he shall appear in his glory. All right. It's this. They're going to, what's that again? Take pleasure in her stones, favor in her dirt. I'm going to show you. Let me skip this one. I'll come back to it. But check this out. All right. This is the temple sifting project. All right. I was just in Israel. I just came back Saturday. And I was there in April. I was just there again. And in one of the visits, we went to the Temple Mount Sifting Project. Not to be confused with Temple Mount Institute. They're two separate things. But how the Temple Sifting Project got started was this. Back in 1999, the Palestinian Authority decided to start an decided to change some things underneath the Al-Aqsa Mosque. And they started digging, and they extracted 9,000 tons of dirt. And they did it like at night. They did it trying to go undercover so the Israelis wouldn't know about it. How do you get rid of 9,000 tons of dirt without them knowing about it? It wasn't easy. But they almost managed to get away with it. But there were two gentlemen that noticed that they were taking the dirt out and they were dumping the dirt in the Kidron Valley. And what they did is they said, hey, in all of that dirt, there's going to be a whole bunch of Jewish artifacts. And there is. And it's truly amazing. And what they started, they were able to get that dirt and start to sift through it. And that's what they've been doing. They're still doing it. 9,000 tons of dirt, sifting through it, finding coins, all kinds of artifacts that point to the era of the Jewish kingdom in Israel, even before the Romans came along. Truly an amazing thing. In fact, there is a jewelry store. I'm not saying go there and buy jewelry. I'm not advocating spending money, although my wife did. But but if they're in the Jewish quarter by the Great Synagogue, I think it's called Moriah or something like that, and they take some of the precious metals and other things that they get in the sifting project that they aren't turning over to the museum, and they turn them into jewelry and the funds they're sifting. But it's just the most amazing thing. And everywhere you go in Israel, it's absolutely incredible. There's more and more archaeology, more and more discoveries. When coronavirus came, Israel shut down, but their digging didn't. And I look at Psalm 102 and I think, wow, they take pleasure in her stones. The day is coming when they will take pleasure in her stones and delight in her dirt. And you see that and you go, this is just crazy how accurate God's word is when you see all these different prophecies being fulfilled. The land will be prepared for crops for the Jews to come home. Ezekiel chapter 36. Again, when I was there, I loved it just talking with the group, being prepared, the hills being prepared for the people to come back home to live on them. Everywhere you go, you see crops. It's like I was there in April, I saw a lot, and I was there now, and I saw even more. There's another prophecy. You see it in both Ezekiel 39 and also in Revelation 19, where the birds of the air are going to gather together to eat the flesh of those who die in the battle. It's a great cleanup. Revelation 19 is the cleanup before the millennial kingdom begins. Somebody's got to clean up that mess. I'm not going to get into that battle. Well, God calls the birds of the prey to do that. So we went and visited the Hula Valley, which, and it's a bird sanctuary is what it's become. So when the Jews started taking the land back, officially in 1948, but even pre that, they started drying up the swampland with eucalyptus trees and so forth. But to make a conservation area, because it was a lot of swampland, they had this reserve in the Hula Valley. And so you see the swampland there and everything. Well, it's become this since 1940, whatever it is, it's pre-48. But since then, this area has become this preserve for birds, where the birds nest, the birds have kids. And you think, this is interesting. Because God says, I'm going to bring the birds there. And they're already there. And you look at this and you go, you can't make this stuff up. And then David Tal, who's a good Israeli friend of mine, he was our guide. He said there's 250 million birds that go this way through the Jezreel Valley, a.k.a. Armageddon, and 250 million that go that way every single year. It's the center point for bird migration. And you think, and now he has this place where birds have babies right there. Like, for me, I don't know, it's just kind of wild. I get excited about a lot of things. God says, I'll put watchers on your walls. By the way, there's video cameras everywhere in the old city of Jerusalem. not just Bible watchers, literally watchers on the walls, video cameras. Isn't that crazy? I don't know. Do what you want with it, but check this out. Also when we were there, I think it was last Thursday, we were walking around the Jewish quarter. This is the Western Wall. I'll talk about this in a second. We're walking around the Jewish quarter, and in front of the great synagogue, there's a big gold menorah, and all these kids are just playing on the steps, little kids, right? You can't do that in California. I don't know if you can do that in Vegas, let your kids run wild in the streets. You certainly can't do it where I come from. But the prophecy from Zechariah says that the little children are going to play in the streets when they're gathered back home again. They're playing all over in the Jewish quarter in front of the great synagogue. And then we're walking over to the area of Caiaphas' house, and this group of school kids comes along, probably about 30 kids led by their teacher, little kids, 8, 9 years old. They're just singing and jumping up and down. I don't know all the words they were saying, but they were definitely saying shalom and some other words in Hebrew, just full of joy. So my wife got the video, and they're all shouting, and the teacher's with them. It was so cool to see. And then you have this, all these kids at the Western Wall in Jerusalem. You think, man, this is so cool. And you see the quote from Zechariah here. And the streets of the city of Jerusalem will be filled with boys and girls playing in its streets. It's prophecy after prophecy that we see coming together. I don't believe they're going to ultimately have their fulfillment until the tribulation period and then ultimately in the millennial kingdom. But we're watching everything converge right now as God is preparing everything. All right. I have 10 things, right? I've gone through 2. What? I better Billy won't invite me back ever. I'll pick up the pace a little bit. So Bible prophecy expresses God's sovereignty. God is in complete control, whether or not we believe it, whether or not we receive it. Jan Markell said, I was with her at a conference last February, and she has commented that somebody is complaining as a prophecy person about how bad everything was. And she said, well, what did you expect the last days to look like, right? I mean, the Bible tells us, hence the proper ability to be able to read the signs properly, right? And know what the manual actually says. But everything is happening just like God said. And what we're watching is this powerful system of the beast being developed. Let me read just a couple of quotes to you. This is from one of my books, America in the New World Order. Let me see if I can find it here. I left my book I quote from at home, so I don't have it highlighted in here. This is going to take another 10 minutes. I know it's in here. It was in it earlier. Let's see. I'm going to find it. Okay, I found it. H.G. Wells, right? Full-on globalist, atheist. H.G. Wells, in 1936, he forecast the coming of a world brain. He envisioned something that we would compare to the internet with AI. He also believed that in the future, every person would have an identity number, and the world brain would know all the basic facts about each individual. I look at this and go, this is, so what we actually see developing right now from, you know, Yuval Noah Harari, any of you heard of him, Bill Gates, Klaus Schwab, these people, I believe H.G. Wells set the direction for them to go. I mean, when you read what they're doing, it's like they've got his manual out from his books that he wrote and said, okay, we're going to do this. H.G. Wells said a special squad of elites would solve all the problems. He believed that it needed to be solved. Smart, emotionally uninvolved. In other words, we don't care how many billions of people die, right? That's, we're going to solve everything. Scientifically minded people can solve everything if given the authority to do it. He believed that most problems have only one solution, and that without emotional entanglements, the elites would quickly see it. The elites would have full access to the World Brain's population database, knowing the whereabouts and basic data on every person in the world at all times. You look at that, okay, and we know it. The Bible told us this way, way, way before H.G. Wells put it into book format. But so these globalists are not following the Bible's format. They're following someone like H.G. Wells and the devil, but the Bible told us this is what these people are going to do so we can understand how things are going. People considered plain or dull or stupid would either be exterminated or sent away to an abandoned island. Think of, what was that term Hillary Clinton used for?
Deplorables,
right? That's basically put that, people considered deplorables. I mean, put that in there. He also believed that, get this, the elites would take on the job of rewiring the human mind. What a quinky-dink. In the New World Order, his book, he said countless people hate the New World Order and will die protesting against it. Yes, they will. George Orwell, countering H.G. Wells, wrote what is called a dystopian novel in 1984, and he said this, during the times of universal deceit, telling the truth becomes a revolutionary act. We can already see where we're going right now. You are censored if you tell the truth about what is really going on. Bible prophecy expresses God's sovereignty. Be strong in the Lord. The Bible tells us it's going to go this way, okay? Number four, Bible prophecy demonstrates God's love. David Reagan wrote, the skeptics of Bible prophecy misconstrue its prophecies as being too general or too vague or too big. But if you take a closer look, God provides many specific details about his plan for the ages. The plan shows how God is working to bring humanity back into a right relationship with him so that one day we shall dwell in a blessed time of peace, righteousness, and fellowship with our Creator. Bible prophecy can be very specific and very purposeful, for God explains how his plan will unfold through his prophetic word. Todd Hampson writes, Bible prophecy demonstrates that God loves us and that he has a plan for our lives. We're not just floating around on a big spinning orb out in the outer space with no purpose and no meaning, as atheists claim. God has crafted a purpose for every person he has ever made because he loves his children. God has also planned a destination for the faithful. He wants us to live for him in heaven and on the new earth forever. And so he gives us prophecy to show how world history will end with the faithful living forever with our loving Heavenly Father in the eternal state. Listen, praise God. Listen, I can tell you one reason why you hear so much, or you and I get so much pushback against Bible prophecy, is because the devil hates it. You want to know why? Because it does tell us about God's love and our future home. And the other thing that it does, it gives us the retirement plan that God has for the devil. And he doesn't like that retirement plan. And he doesn't want people to know about it. He wants people to think he is king. Hence, he's going to attempt to usurp the authority of Jesus, sit in the temple, demand to be worshipped as God, and attempt to take out Jesus. It ain't going to work. I wish I could give that message today, but I can't. Number five, it reveals God's plan, so we don't need to be afraid. Don't need to be afraid. Check this out. Let's see if I got a few things here. Nope, just one. I think I have a couple on my phone, too. So look at this. This is from, I think this is about 4 or 5 weeks ago. Some of you probably saw it. This is playing with fire. It could spark a lab-generated pandemic. Experts slam Boston lab where scientists have created a new deadly Omicron strain with an 80% kill rate in mice. Well, isn't that rather sweet? I mean, they tell us, how could you talk about these kind of things? You guys are all bad. Well, you guys, look at what you guys are doing. They're going to create this. But I look at all of these things just feeding into Revelation chapter 6, the pale horse, the pestilences, and so forth. And then there's this. Let's see here. I'm going to pull it up for you. Give me a minute. Oh, here's one. I forgot about this. FDA announces lab-grown meat. Yeah. Ready? Yeah. Get this. You ready for this? Yeah. How many of you are aware that there's this COP27 climate meeting going on in Egypt, right? Okay. FDA announces lab-grown meat that was served at the COP27 climate conference is safe to eat. Safe to eat. Soylent Green. Who said Soylent Green? So true. How many of you saw that movie, right? Oh, man, here it is, like 50 years later, still Soylent Green. But it's, I mean, you start to look at this, go, lab-grown meat. Hey, what a quinky-dink. Look at this. Clearing the way for the California-based company that creates cell-cultured chicken to begin selling this product. I wonder if Billy Crone would eat that chicken. Because we know he ain't eating any other chicken. Okay, here's this. Don't be afraid. Listen to this. This is last night's news. Doctors beg Biden to take action as killer virus sends record number of kids to hospital. So, you know, we hear these things, and we don't need to be afraid, right? What did Jesus say in Luke chapter 21? I'll read it to you because all of a sudden I'm drawing blanks. He said something. Here's a, and there will be signs in the sun, in the moon, and in the stars, and on earth, distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring. Men's hearts will fail them from the fear and expectation of those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Men's hearts will be afraid, whether it be from the thought of asteroids hitting the earth or more pandemics. I can promise you, because of what Jesus said, there will be more pandemics, and they're going to be far worse than anything we've seen. He said there's going to be an increase in earthquakes in various places. Pestilence is plural. And these will increase like birth pains upon a pregnant woman. But don't be afraid. Because he told us this. He warned us ahead of time so we would know, so we would understand. Men's hearts will fail them from what's coming. People are so afraid of climate change. I'll tell you, this freaked me out with the climate, how cold it is in Vegas. I wasn't expecting it. So, that was a climate change meeting for my head. You know what? If you're as old as me, you understand that until a year ago it was called weather, but now we call it climate change. It used to be called global warming until they realized, hey, everything's really cold sometimes, right? But then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Now, when these things begin to happen, look up and lift up your heads because your redemption draws near. Amen. And lift up your heads. By the way, it's look up, right? And lift up your heads, it meaning with expectant joy. Because I don't ever take joy over the signs because some of these signs are very destructive. And people already are just die from terrible things. But our hope is in Jesus Christ. So Jesus warned us, listen, this is what's going to happen. There is going to be a mark of the beast. These globalists are bad people. They want to get rid of your head. There's going to be pestilences. In this case, starting to look like created in labs by evil men. You look, you go, wow. Jesus said, it's going to look like this. Isaiah chapter 46. Remember this and show yourselves men. Remember the former things of old. For I am God and there is no other. I am God and there's none like me. Declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times. Things that are not yet, saying, my counsel shall stand and I will do all my pleasure. Indeed, I have spoken it. I will also bring it to pass. I have purposed it. I will do it. We don't have to be afraid. Number six, it keeps us from being deceived. Speaking of climate change. Pope Francis, this is a while back. Like, I think he's done this like 1,000 times now. Pope Francis calls on humanity to repent for abuse of Mother Earth. And then this was a fringe group at this religious COP27 meeting in Egypt who go out to a fake Mount Sinai. At least I believe it's not the real Mount Sinai where they went. Activists smashed tablets atop Mount Sinai to launch faith-based climate push. Their 10 commandments. I mean, you look up there. Did anybody see the video on this? I mean, the stuff is just so absurd. But professing to be wise, God says, I'll show them to be fools. Romans chapter 1, right? They'll worship the creation rather than the creator. What we are watching right now is this Mother Earth is being lifted up. Here is your God worship. Kind of like the Israelites when they built the cow with everybody's jewelry, right? And Moses comes down the mountain. What are you guys doing? Well, we just threw in a bunch of rings and earrings, and out came this cow. So what can we do? Well, we decided to dance naked around it and worship it. I mean, what else would you do, Moses? But this is, I mean, it's kind of like that. Let's lift up Mother Earth. But what's happening is getting faith-based institutions, Christian in name, to say, yeah, we, you know what? Yeah, if, listen, we all heard it, right? If you really love Jesus, we heard it from the religious leaders in America. If you really love Jesus, then you're going to do X, Y, and Z the last 3 years. What's going to, I promise you, what's going to come with this climate stuff? If you really love the Lord, then you're going to put the climate and the care of Mother Earth, because it's caring about your children and your grandchildren. If you don't care about anybody if you still meet in church, because I tell you, the day is coming when driving like we do and all of these different things, gathering. Listen, the devil hates us gathering. And it's going to be, if you really love Jesus, then you're going to be part of this and you're going to be lifting up. Here is your God worship. Well, why? Why is this? Don't be deceived. This is from Harbingers. Is unbelief the real reason America's pulpits are silent regarding prophecy? Yes. People don't believe. Pastors do not believe the Bible. That's what's happening. Listen to this. Jeremiah chapter 14. Let me read just a few verses, if I can find the right ones. Verse 13, Jeremiah chapter 14. Then I said, ah, Lord God, behold, the prophets say to the people, you shall not see the sword, nor shall you have famine, but I will give you assured peace in this place. So Jeremiah is saying the prophets that Jerusalem now has, they had bad false prophets, false priests, false judges, false politicians, fake kings, right? That's what they had. Babylon has sieged them. They're surrounding them. They're starving them out. They're going to kill them. Jeremiah's warning, you guys, here's what you can do. If you repent, the whole thing's over. You don't have to worry about it. God will save. But the prophets are coming along saying, shut up, Jeremiah. Throw them into a hole, which they did. Keep your mouth shut. Jeremiah is saying, you prophets, you false prophets are saying, everything's going to be good. Go along with the system. That's what he's talking about. And the Lord said to me, this is Jeremiah, the prophets prophesy lies in my name. I have not sent them, commanded them, nor spoken to them. They prophesy to you a false vision, divination, a worthless thing, and the deceit of their heart. Wow. Therefore, thus says the Lord concerning the prophets who prophesy in my name, whom I did not send, and who say, sword and famine shall not be in this land. Ah, but sword and famine, those prophets shall be by sword and famine. Those prophets shall be consumed. Wow. Then the people will be cast out into the streets. They would not listen to the truth. They wouldn't repent. Bible prophecy keeps us from being deceived. And I'll tell you, let me say this, all right? Regardless of where you are on the political thing, maybe it's because I'm from California and nobody I vote for ever wins. Except, check this out. It looks like I actually promoted from the pulpit. I did an interview with this gentleman for school board. He's so on fire for the Lord. He started the Lexit movement in California, Latinos exiting the left. And Ken Prado, great, great brother in Christ. And it looks like he's going to win. They're still counting. I mean, I'm like, they're still counting, but I'm so excited. He's the only person I ever promoted, ever from the pulpit. And it looks like he's going to win. I'm excited. But regardless, here's the problem, right? We cannot put our hope in a politician. Our hope is in Jesus Christ. And there are corrupt people on the left. There's corrupt people on the right. And what we need to repent. We need Jesus Christ. And I do have many friends that say, listen, as long as there's Christians here, God isn't going to judge America. I have some very close friends that say that. I'm not going to mention any names because they're great guys. But I think they're wrong because I think we're personally, we can't know this for sure. It appears to me that we're already kind of in that place and we're experiencing it. But when you look at the Israel of old and Judah of old, listen, they suffered. I'm not talking about the rapture, right? We have the days of Noah and the days of Lot to help illustrate that. I'm not talking about that. But what happened with both Israel and Judah, there were great men of God who were taken to Babylon, who were captured, who were sawn in two. There were people, there were Jews in Israel and Jews in Judah who suffered, who loved the Lord, but the countries as a whole, the nations as a whole, were totally corrupt. They couldn't get on the left or right. It was messed up. Listen, I believe we're going to be raptured before the tribulation begins. But if I were to tell you 3 years ago, hey, this is what's coming over the next 3 years. No way, we're going to be raptured before any of that nutty stuff happens. Well, here we are, right? You know, and you keep seeing things, right? So just keep that in mind before you throw things at me. Number 7, it proves God is the only one who is worthy. I love this. Billy never should have said I had till noon. Or maybe he didn't say it. Maybe I just made that up in my head. Revelation chapter 4, right? God is the only one who is worthy. The four living creatures, each having 6 wings, were full of eyes around and within, and they do not rest day or night, saying, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. And whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him who sits on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him who sits on the throne and worship him who lives forever and ever and cast their crown before the throne, saying, you are worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they exist and were created. Continues in chapter 5. Now when the Lord Jesus Christ had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each having a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song. You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain and have redeemed us to God by your blood out of every tribe and tongue and people and nation, and have made us kings and priests to our God, and we shall reign on earth. And then I looked and I heard the voice of many angels around the throne, the living creatures and the elders, and the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. And every creature which is in heaven and on earth and under the earth and such as are in the sea and all that are in them, I heard saying, blessing and honor and glory and power be to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb forever and ever and ever. Amen. God is the only one who is worthy. Amen. Number 8. This I knew. Indeed, thank you for letting me do that. Because if I didn't. So it reminds us that God will crush all evil. I can't wait. I see children being abducted. You know, the whole Jeffrey Epstein thing that every politician in the world involved seems to be getting away with. Horrible crimes in cities. People being killed in the street for sports. Bystanders just looking on. Murders getting away with murder. Victims being victimized by the media after they've already been victimized by somebody else. The kid stuff just really, really, really bothers me. This Babylon Bee post really helps to understand this. Look at this. Men wearing lingerie pants wants to spend time with your kids hour. Right? It says this. Interest in drag queen story hours wanes after they renamed more accurate men wearing lingerie pants. Well, we see this, right? You're thinking, how could this possibly be? I'll tell you what bothers me more than a school that does it is a parent that would have their kid in that. Parents are grooming their own children. Oh, we just want to get along, and you religious people are crazy. It's terrible. Jesus has come back. He's going to fix this mess. Think of this. This describes our world. Ecclesiastes chapter 11. Because sentence against an evil work is not executed speedily, therefore the heart of the sons of men is fully set to do evil. Isn't that what it is? It used to be. Remember that TV show? This is going to take me too. Beretta. Remember that? A 5'6" man in a 6-foot world or whatever it was. And it used to, the theme song was, don't do the crime if you can't do the time. That doesn't apply. Yeah, don't do it. That's right. Don't do it. Keep your eye on the sparrow, that thing, right? I have stuff that pops in my head that's such a waste of time. It's a mess. Gilligan's Island theme song never goes away. Daniel chapter 9. Daniel has these visions and dreams. At the beginning of your supplications, the angel comes to him. The command went out. And I have come to tell you, Daniel, for you are greatly beloved. Therefore, consider the matter and understand the vision. 70 weeks are determined for your people, for your holy city. Who's that? For the Jewish people and for the city of Jerusalem. What for? Listen to this. To finish the transgression, make an end of sins, make reconciliation for iniquity, bring in everlasting righteousness, seal up vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. Amen. The Lord's going to do it. He's going to fix all of this stuff. He is coming back. By the way, just for the record, for those people who believe in replacement theology, this is just nuts. This means none of this is going to be fulfilled if replacement theology is real. Forget the 70 weeks. They're just meaningless. It's just made up stuff. Daniel didn't know what he was writing about, you know, that kind of stuff. He says to finish the transgression, to make an end of sin. This is why. Listen, I promise you, when Jesus ascended and went to heaven and he's reunited with the Father in heaven, he didn't, this is not how the conversation went. He didn't go say, hey, Dad, here's what happened. You know, I went to the cross and I died and was buried and I resurrected. I saved a whole bunch of people. But I came back early because, well, I lost Jerusalem. I lost the Jews. In fact, I lost planet Earth. I lost all of creation. In fact, everything's just going to continue in a sinful mess. But I saved some people. That's not how the conversation went. Replacement theology essentially teaches that. Jesus is coming back to claim what is his. 70 weeks are determined for your people. He will rule and reign from Jerusalem. There's going to be Jews there. There's going to be a beautiful planet Earth. He's going to reform it. It's going to be absolutely incredible. All is his. Jesus lost nothing. He owns everything that there is. And Satan didn't go before the Father and say, Satan won. I won a little bit, but Satan won everything. Oh, Satan, he was tough. That's just insane. But there's many people in churches that essentially, if you work out their theology, that's what it would come down to. Jesus is coming back. Number nine, it makes us want to be right with the Lord when we understand Bible prophecy. 2 Peter chapter 3, but the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens will pass away with a great noise, and the elements will melt with fervent heat. Both the earth and the works that are in it will be burned up. Therefore, since all these things will be dissolved, what manner of persons ought you to be in holy conduct and godliness? Looking for and hastening the coming of the day of God. Listen, I look at this and I think, because of Bible prophecy, I want to be ready. I mean, it makes me say, okay, I got to be about my Father's business. I don't want to be messing up with stuff I shouldn't be messing up. You know what I mean? It makes us, I think it puts a fire in our heart. That's a right understanding of Bible prophecy should do this. There's many people that say, oh, you're just too heavenly minded, so you're no earthly good. It's the opposite of what God says. You want to be any earthly good, you got to be more heavenly minded, because your mind is fixed on Jesus Christ and Him coming back. And you want to be found worthy of the name Christ follower. All this leads us to number 10. The last one, it gives us hope. Everything is going exactly as the Lord said it would. In Matthew chapter 25, in the Olivet Discourse, Jesus is telling us how things are going to go. And he says this, verse 24, for false Christs and false prophets will rise and show great signs and wonders to deceive, if possible, even the elect. And then he says, see, I have told you beforehand. I've told you beforehand. So you can know that the Bible is true, that Bible prophecy is true. So when we see all of this stuff happening, we can go, aha, it's going to be okay. It's going to be good. Well, think of it like this. Oh, I lost a slide. Oh, it was my favorite slide too. Man. It was, listen, here it is. I'll give it to you in a nutshell. Prophecy is warning of the bad, is a warning of the bad news that points to the good news, yeah. Right? That's what it is. It's a warning of the bad news that points to the good news, the great news. And again, with that, remember the words of Jesus from Luke chapter 21. When you see these things, right, already read it, begin to take place, look up and lift up your head with expectant joy, because your redemption draws near. Amen. Lord, we thank you for your word and your ministry to us, that you love us and you keep us. May we be strengthened. We pray for your blessings on the rest of the conference today, all day tomorrow, in Jesus' name.